Good morning and welcome to the Missouri History Museum. My name is Aaron Pelker and I'm a Community Engagement Coordinator with the Museum's Public History Division. And I want to thank you for spending part of your Tuesday morning with us here at the museum. Before we get to this morning's lecture, I do have some brief remarks. First, I'd like to thank our museum members and the Zoo Museum Tax District. Without each of their support, we wouldn't be able to host programs like this morning's. If you're interested in learning more about becoming a museum member, please visit our website, mohistory.org, that is mohistory.org/support. Next, I want to mention that today's program is part of a month-long programming series highlighting and celebrating Women's History Month. Our next Women's History Month program is on Thursday evening at 6:30, titled She Votes with Bridget Quinn, right here in the Lee Auditorium. Also, our next daytime program will be back here in the auditorium in 2 weeks on April 5th with a program titled Hidden in Plain Sight with the museum's community tours manager, Amanda Clark. We hope to see you back here at the museum for both of those programs. Also, before we begin today's lecture, I want to encourage you to visit the museum's restaurant, Cafe St. Louis by Pure, which is open now until 2 p.m. on the museum's top level after the conclusion of the lecture. So if you're looking for lunch, you don't need to look far. But with that, I'd like to introduce our featured speaker, Bev Schuetz. Bev's a longtime friend of the Missouri History Museum, and her background includes degrees in English, drama, and graduate work in history. Her History Talks lecture series features over 40-something different topics, which combine her skills in public speaking, historical analysis, and creative writing. Bev is a retired executive from the medical publishing field, and since her retirement has delivered lectures on a wide array of historical topics, many times here at the museum. So please join me in welcoming back to the podium Bev Schuetz with three women, the treacherous, the bold, and the brilliant. Thanks and enjoy.
I can't tell you how wonderful it is to be back in this beautiful building and to see some familiar faces. This is one of my favorite places to speak. And today, being Women's History Month, I have the pleasure to tell you about three remarkable women. I've chosen a single adjective to fit each one of them, or a single word. The first one I call treacherous. Her name is actually Peggy Shippen, and that may not be a word that's familiar to you, but you will recognize her married name, Mrs. Benedict Arnold. The name of her husband is still one of the most hated names in American history, but recent discoveries have told us that she may have been the key perpetrator in the plot to betray America. For most of history, she was regarded as a woman who was wronged and disgraced by her traitor husband. But now we believe she was a willing conspirator and one of the most overlooked traitors in all of American history. Peggy Shippen was born in 1760 in Philadelphia, just a few years before the Revolutionary War, and she was born into a prominent family. She was the fourth youngest daughter of Judge Shippen, and she was considered by everyone to be the family darling. She was born with brilliant prospects. Family house guests included such notables as George Washington, Benjamin Franklin, and Betsy Ross. She was very privileged. When she was 14, the revolution began, and it began to interfere with her social life. She was blonde and beautiful and willful. She was also bright and vivacious with the ability to charm men. Her father had tried to stay independent of the sides in the war. He tried to remain neutral, but as the war progressed, his finances became increasingly strained and that walking the middle line got more and more difficult. When Peggy turned 18, the British were occupying Philadelphia. And this beautiful, vibrant young woman delighted in the social world that the British officers introduced. And at this time, she was courted by a very dashing young officer named Jean André. Some think she was actually in love with him. When the British left Philadelphia, the Patriots would take over running the city. The young men were sent back to New York, and André went with them. And now, Peggy was left with a new group of men, and pretty soon she became acquainted with the head, General Benedict Arnold. He was a patriot's hero, and he was now appointed the commanding officer of the city. He was 38, he was a widower, and he had three sons who were being raised by his sister in another city. As a young man, he had gone into the import-export business. He grew increasingly frustrated and active with the British when they kept imposing more and more restrictions on him. So now, with the war pending, he formed a militia where he would serve as the captain. He distinguished himself with his intelligence and his bravery. He was promoted then to Major General. He led 1,000 soldiers into Quebec, crossing into the difficult wilderness. They endured many things: torrential rains, devastating floods, blinding snowstorms, and severe food shortages. Things were so bad that they were forced to eat their own moccasins and then eventually their dogs. He had spent his own money to supply the expedition to Canada, and he had never been reimbursed. And this would be a festering basis for his anger at the Patriots. It would also contribute to his financial problems in the future. He had also been crippled with wounds while he was in battle. And since he couldn't stand on his wounded leg, he was sent to Philadelphia to serve as the military governor, a less stressful position. He was promoted at that time to Brigadier General. And within 2 weeks of his arrival in Philadelphia, the 38-year-old general had met and was now spending a great deal of time with the barely 18-year-old Peggy Shippen. Oh, he cut a very impressive figure, even though he was lame. He had broad shoulders and a muscular physique and a very fearless manner. He maintained a high style, a lavish style of living, and this was very appealing to young Peggy, who loved beautiful clothes and parties. And in order to finance this lifestyle, he began to be involved in some questionable business dealings. They would marry in 1779, and his finances became increasingly strained, trying to keep up with the demands of his beautiful socialite wife and with his position. The conditions were now ready for him to consider the betrayal. He needed money. He coveted recognition for past services. He was very discontented, and he harbored a lot of grievances. He felt other officers were claiming credit for things he had done. His adversaries now brought charges of corruption against him, and that included profiteering. This was widespread at the time, and conviction for him would mean possible imprisonment and disgrace. All the seeds were there for him to commit treason. He resigned his military governorship in Philadelphia. He wanted to recover his reputation, and he wanted to restore his health. And he demanded an immediate court-martial from Washington. But Washington said, "We need to take time to gather evidence." And Arnold was furious. He said, "Delay is worse than death." He was at a breaking point, and he now, with his marriage, had an ally: his astute, able, awe-inspiring wife. She had her own set of grievances with people, and together the two of them decided they would offer their services to the enemy. They decided they would secretly change sides. They initiated plans to negotiate with the British enemy. Now, keep in mind, this was not an intellectual switch. They meant to be well paid for their treason. They didn't do it because they thought this country would be better off under the British. They did it for money. So who was the mastermind behind America's most infamous act of treason? Was it Benedict Arnold alone? Was it Peggy Shippen? Was it both of them? Well, here's what we know for sure. Once the decision was made, Peggy was a full partner, a co-conspirator. Arnold had taken the loyalty oath to support the United States, but Peggy had not. She had only pledged to support her husband. Both of them were treacherous, but Peggy was true. The timing suggests that Peggy was the catalyst. It all started a month after their wedding. Most of those who were involved came from her world, not from his. They were contacts and people she had known, the key one being Jean André, Peggy's close personal friend, a man who had never, ever met Benedict Arnold. Jean André re-entered the picture after he had now become aide and close friend to the British General Clinton in New York. He was appointed by General Clinton to the Secret Service. He was his spy chief. And 2 weeks after he had received this important appointment, Peggy Shippen contacted him about a man he did not know, saying they wanted to betray their country. The Continental Army's most ferocious warrior was ready to perpetrate treason. The message that André received was, "Are you interested in our helping you?" And he was surprised, and he was definitely interested. He told them yes, he would agree to reward them for their services, but he wanted things like information about troop deployment and the location of their gunpowder supplies, names of other defectors, things like this. The plot would proceed over the ensuing months. The British were very interested in the fort at West Point, and the Arnolds, as a result, were very desirous of being assigned there. But instead, Washington threw a little cog in the wheel. He planned to make Arnold a battlefield commander again, send him back out into the war. And Arnold was visibly upset, and Peggy flew through a hysterical fit. Now, this was something that supposedly women of the upper class did frequently at this time. Nobody would listen to them, so it was called hysteria. They would have some kind of a fit, and she evidently had a really royal one. But then Washington changed his plans, and in 1780, they did make Benedict Arnold the commander of West Point. Now, this was, at the time, a strategically important fort and a vital stronghold for the Continental Army, a scheme now developed in which Arnold agreed he would surrender the fort to the British. The plan was for Arnold to pretend to build up the defenses while actually weakening their fighting strength. Instead of bringing troops in, they would keep them away and only bring in the troops in time for the British to capture them. It also involved the possibility of capturing General Washington. So now, in a clandestine secret meeting, Arnold met with Jean André, and he gave him the maps and the information and all this data on West Point, including a safe passage permit, which he signed himself. On his return to the British sector, André was captured, and they discovered those papers hidden in his shoe, the plot to betray America. Now, at this point, Benedict Arnold is totally unaware that his cohort, Jean André, has been captured. And they send word to Benedict Arnold that General Washington is coming to investigate West Point. And when he comes, he's going to see that nothing has been done to prepare that fort. So the treason was about to be revealed, and that message that they told of André's capture was actually received by Arnold right before Washington was due to arrive. So it's all crashing in on him. He raced up to his wife, and he had a few moments of a private, desperate conversation with her, telling her that their plot was now about to be exposed. And he left abruptly, telling her he had to go to West Point. But instead, he dashed to the river and ordered his 9-man barge to row him to the British sloop, the Vulture. He tied a white flag on his rifle and boarded the boat. Thomas Paine later said it was one vulture receiving another vulture. The British now took Arnold. He was the complete turnover to them. Washington and his entourage now came to West Point. And when they got there, they were stunned at what they saw. The fort the condition of it was a travesty. There had been no deployment of the troops. There was no improvement in the barracks. There was no General Arnold to meet them. There was no cannon salute to welcome them. There was no awareness that Washington was even due to come. They couldn't realize, figure out what was going on. So they returned to Benedict Arnold's home. And when they got there, that messenger was waiting to tell them about the capture of John Andre and all the information they had found in his shoe. And they said, Washington was a man who rarely showed feelings, but this time, in a burst of emotion, he sobbed aloud and he said, Arnold has betrayed us. He was also told when he got there that Mrs. Arnold had become hysterical and was nearing madness. She had run through the house shrieking and loudly screaming. It was as if she had lost her mind. They said it expressed utter frenzy, raving madness, great distress. They called in a doctor to try to calm her, but he couldn't. She insisted on seeing Washington, and when Washington came into her room, she said it wasn't Washington, that it was some man there to kill her child. She said her husband had died. One description of her that is fascinating read, her hair was disheveled and flowing around her neck. She wore her mourning gown with few other clothes remaining on her, too few to even be seen by a gentleman of the family, much less by strangers. In other words, she comes out really alluring. I mean, she's out there to capture whatever attention with her feminine wiles. How were we to judge these mad ravings? Well, Washington, for one, exonerated her. He urged compassion because of her sex and her virtues. All of the other men viewed her as poor and distressed, an unhappy, frantic lady. Peggy inspired the defense of men. All of them felt a woman was just too flighty for treason. She was too virtuous for such an act. She was a woman and therefore incapable of such an act. Now today, to us, it seems like over-the-top theater, but they bought it. The timing appears to have been a distraction, so Benedict Arnold could have had time to escape. He got to the boat, but she had no aides. She had no boat. She had no bargemen to help her, as all she had were her wits. She was left alone with a six-month-old baby. But the one thing she knew was that the men would ask no questions because they were so confident that a fragile woman could not possibly have conspired in such a plot. The next day, she claimed no memory of the entire event. And one day, after having thrown the mother of all hissy fits, she calmly wrote to the British asking the money that was due Arnold be sent to her. So what happened to this cast of characters? Well, after he was captured, John Andre was sentenced to death, and he was hung like a common criminal. 4 decades later, his body was interred in a place of high honor in London's Westminster Abbey. You see it there today. And what about Peggy? Well, she had was defended by her husband, who wrote General Washington asking for her protection. She wound up going to New York to be with her husband, along with the baby and the 3 stepsons of Benedict Arnold, as well as his sister. The British honored the agreement they had made with Andre, and they paid Benedict Arnold for his services. But some of the officers refused to serve under Arnold. They blamed him for Andre's death, and his reputation continued to decline. With the end of the war approaching, the Arnolds moved to London, and there they were well received initially. Peggy continued to have children. She would lose 2, but 5 would survive to adulthood. And Benedict Arnold started a new career. He outfitted a ship for trade and set sail for Canada. But his financial problems continued to mount. He brought his family there, and Peggy was devastated to learn that he had again participated in a betrayal. This time, he had broken his marriage vows and had an illegitimate son. There were now numerous lawsuits, humiliations, and they were forced to move back to London, and he was sinking in financial quicksand. He faced declining physical and mental health, and Benedict Arnold died of dropsy and lung disease in 1801 at the age of 60. So now Peggy was on her own. She was a widow. She was now 41, and she had this large family all dependent on her, and she faced crushing death. But she would spend the remainder of her days providing for her children and pushing them towards success, toward a stable life. She ensured military careers for the boys. She made sure that Hannah, Benedict Arnold's spinster sister, was provided for. She even took care of his illegitimate son. Her children would be her triumph and her legacy. She contracted uterine cancer and died in 1804 at the age of 44. So how should we remember Peggy Shippen Arnold? She was a quintessential American in her bravery and in her improvisation. She believed the ends justified the means. She was not loyal to her country, but she was unremittingly loyal to her husband and to her children. She thought she'd find fame and fortune, but instead she just found financial duress and infamy. But we have finally today discovered this fascinating story of her survival and endurance in the pages of history, and I've had the pleasure of sharing it with you today. Now, our next woman, I give the word bold to her. She is an amazing lady who was born Elizabeth Jane Cochran on May 5, 1864. She would later take the pen name Nellie Bly. Her birthplace was Cochran's Mill, Pennsylvania. It was a town that was named after her father. Now, he was a prominent citizen. He was a wealthy landowner and a judge, and he had 10 children by his first wife. She died, he married again, and he had 5 more children by this wife. The third child was our Elizabeth, and everybody considered her to be the rebellious, spunky one in the family. They always dressed her in pink, and they called her Pinky for short. She led an idyllic, privileged life until she was 6 years old, and then her father died. There was no will to protect the second family, and his death was a financial blow. A few years later, they were forced to sell the mansion. They were in desperate financial straits. So, needing financial security, the mother rather hastily entered into a disastrous marriage to a violent and abusive man who was actually dangerous to the children. Finally, she filed for divorce. That wasn't easy in those days. Divorce was very rare at this time. In a population of 40,000 in 1878, there were 15 divorces. Nellie was now forced to grow up. She wanted to become a teacher, but there wasn't money for an education. She eventually would move with her mother to Pittsburgh, where she would live for the next 7 years, and there she helped her mother run a boarding house. The city was an industrial city. She finally did, though, find a career opportunity. Pittsburgh's most popular writer expounded in his column that women belonged in the home doing domestic tasks like sewing, cooking, and raising children. He called working women a monstrosity. The author was Erasmus Wilson, and he used the pen name Quiet Observer, QO, for his articles. Well, when Elizabeth read that, she became angry, and she wrote a quick retort to the paper. She didn't sign her name. She just signed it Lonely Orphan Girl. And she told them in no uncertain terms that many young women had to work just to survive, that it was a necessity, not a choice. The paper was impressed with her spirit, and they wanted to hire her. But she hadn't put any name on the paper, so they wrote their article and addressed it to Lonely Orphan Girl. And fortunately, she read it, responded. They offered her a job and a new pen name, Nellie Bly. Her first story was about the difficulties of poor working girls. She knew all about that. And the next one was about the problems getting a divorce and the need for a reform of the state's divorce laws. She knew all about that subject too. She did a series on factory working girls in Pittsburgh, their working conditions, the child labor that was employed. She became the champion of the underprivileged. She even was sent to Mexico as a foreign correspondent, but she wanted more. She had been a staff reporter for about a year when she decided she was ready for New York City. She left her champion, Wilson, a note that read, "Dear QO, I'm off to New York. Look out for Bly." For 6 months, she knocked on the doors of New York newspapers. Her goal was to go to work for Joseph Pulitzer, who owned the New York World, because he really had drew the better writers and editors to his paper. Finally, she finagled a way into the office of John Cockrell, who was the managing editor of Joseph Pulitzer's New York World. We're not sure if Cockrell meant to challenge her or if he was just trying to get rid of her, but the job he offered was, would she be willing to write a story about the mentally ill who were housed in a notorious institution in New York City? The place was Blackwell Island. It was a charity hospital and an insane asylum. Rumors abounded about the mentally ill and the terrible conditions that they were kept under. She agreed to have herself committed and to go in undercover to get the true story. Pulitzer promised he would get her out after 10 days, and that is what happened. For 10 horrible days, she impersonated a mad woman on Blackwell's Island. Her story, when it came out, would tell of the cruel beatings, the ice-cold baths, the forced feedings, the improper behavior of doctors, and the horrible rotten food. She didn't just cover the story, she became the story. She was able to show her readers that it was a truly human rat trap. And her report, as a result, stirred the public and the politicians, and it brought about needed reforms to that horrible institution. It brought about other improvements in prisons and hospitals and public charities. And it also meant that Nellie Bly was now hired as a full-time staff reporter for the New York World. She was now able to support and take care of her mother for the rest of her life. In the ensuing years, as a reporter, Bly would expose corruption and the injustice of poverty. She revealed the shady lobbyists. She called attention to the inadequate medical care given to the poor. She described the terrible working conditions, how easy it was to buy a child in those days. She pretended to be a criminal and went to jail, where she was strip searched. As a result of this story, matrons were then finally hired to oversee women. She became known for always siding with the poor and the disenfranchised. And then came the idea that topped them all, her most famous story of all, to travel around the world by ship and train and burrow and beat the record that was the basis for Jules Verne's popular Around the World in 80 Days. They thought about sending Nellie to cover the story, but Pulitzer and his group were hesitant because, you know, she was a woman, and really, wouldn't she need a chaperone? And what about all that luggage that a woman would need to travel? Well, Nellie convinced them that she certainly did not need a chaperone and that she could travel with a single bag. They gave her 48 hours, that's all, to prepare for this journey. She took one dress, and she had it made in one day. She took everything in one small handbag. They would publish her itinerary all along the way with her updates when she landed in a city. Her journey was almost ruined when she was in Egypt. She had asked, "Is there enough time for me to get off of the ship in order to post my story, go to the cable office?" And they told her, "Yes, if you hurry." So she, with a ship's guard, raced to the cable office, and while they're filing the story, they hear that ominous whistle when a ship is about to take off. And they looked at each other, and they were stunned, and they raced through the streets to get to the port to see the ship pulling out, but it wasn't her ship. It was a different one. So she was saved. And finally, after that long journey, on January 15th, she boarded the Oceanic to return to the United States and San Francisco. On the ship's engine was a message: "For Nellie Bly will win or die." These are from the guys on the ship. The pressure was on. She checked every day to see if they had gained a few extra miles. Finally, she had traveled 21,000 miles in 67 days, and she saw the shoreline of America. Now, she would still have to get back east, but she would at least be on home soil. There would be one last scare. A small tug was hired to take her from the big liner onto the shore. And as she was getting ready to leave, the quarantine doctor called out from the ship that he had forgotten to examine her tongue, and she could not land until he checked it. So she stuck out her tongue from way down here. He looked at it and said, "You're all right," and sent her on her way. Then followed a whistle-stop trip with huge cheering crowds, kind of like a political campaign would be. It took Nellie 4.5 days to make it across America. But her final total time when she arrived at her destination was 72 hours, 72 days, 6 hours, 11 minutes, and 15 seconds. And her triumphant story ran the day after her arrival. She was now the most famous woman in the world. She was a marketing success story. This little cap she wore became the latest fashion hit. They made up a board game about her trip. She profited from her lectures and selling of her photos, but she was disappointed in the reaction from Pulitzer and his people. And in the ensuing disappointment, she left the paper for 3 years. She now decided she wanted to be a novelist. But the problem was she could write news stories, but she couldn't write fiction. So she returned to the world and to the Chicago Herald for 5 weeks. And then she made the headlines again. Nellie Bly was getting married. Over the years, there had been stories about romantic involvements with some men, but it never really amounted to anything. But now, the future Mr. Nellie Bly, that's what some of the papers called him, was a man by the name of Robert Seaman. He was 70, and she was 31. He was a millionaire, and he'd made his money manufacturing metal containers. They met, they courted, and they were wed in a 2-week period. Well, he may have had some reservations because he hired a detective to follow his young wife, and then he wrote his will, leaving her $300. Well, when she found all this out, she left him. She went back to work at the World, but he decided he wanted her back. He really didn't want to lose this proud, lovely young wife, so he drew up a new will with Nellie as the executrix and heir to his handsome fortune. From then on, Nellie led this wonderful life as a New York City matron. In 1904, 10 years after they had been married, Seaman was killed by a horse-drawn carriage when he was crossing the street. And so Nellie now became a full-time business entrepreneur and a manager. She had worked hard to make their company solvent, and within a year, she had 25 patents on barrels that she herself had invented. She remembered the deprivation of all those workers she'd covered over the years, and she became a model employer. Everybody received a guaranteed wage. No one was paid by the piece any longer. Her company almost sounds like an internet company of today. There was a $5,000 or 5,000 volume library, a gym, a bowling alley for all the employees. And everybody had access to the health center where a doctor would make a house call for 50 cents. Everybody in Nellie's company was treated well. But she had neglected the bottom line, and there was creeping debt, and then fraud was uncovered, and she was forced into bankruptcy. She had to go back to work at the World, and then later went to Europe on a vacation in 1914. not a very good year to go on a vacation in Europe. She wound up being forced to live in Vienna for 5 years. She reported on the battlefield and visited hospitals and described the horrific injuries. And finally, she was able to come home in 1948. But she found more problems on the home front. Her mother had now sued her for control of the business, and the court sided with Nellie as the rightful owner. It was a bitter end to their relationship, this mother whom she had provided for her entire life. The business finally folded. Nellie was in her 50s, but she needed a job. So she went to work for the New York Evening Journal as an advice columnist. And she continued there to champion labor, to help people find work. She demanded that American shippers hire Americans. She found homes for the children of unwed mothers and acted as her own adoption agency. She also neglected her own health, and she contracted pneumonia. She entered the hospital on January 9th, 1922, and that was the day that her last article appeared in a paper. 2 weeks later, she died. Nellie had risen above personal poverty and a limited education to become a world-renowned and respected reporter, our first investigative journalist. But she was a lot more than that. She was also a businesswoman, an inventor, a war correspondent, and a social activist. She really was Nellie Bly the Bold. The last of our three awesome, fascinating women gets the word brilliant attached to her, and without question, she deserves it, perhaps more than any other woman I have covered in all my various presentations. Marya Sklodowsky would become Marie Curie. She was born in 1867, and the country of her birth theoretically didn't even exist at that time. The country of Poland had been taken over by Russia and had been renamed the Vistula, and the Russians ruled it with a heavy hand. There was no longer a Polish language, no longer any Polish literature or Polish history. All shop signs now had to be in Russian. It was as if Poland itself had to be obliterated. Her family, the Sklodowskis, were proud Polish nationalists and scientific intellectuals. On both the mother and father's side, the family had lost their property and their money due to their patriotic involvements. The father was a science professor who now earned a very meager salary. The Russian authorities had eliminated laboratory instructions from the Polish schools, so he brought the lab equipment home and he privately instructed his children in its use. Marie was the last of five children. She was a brilliant child who, when she was four, picked up a book her older sister had been struggling to read. She opened the book and she read the first paragraph flawlessly. Seeing the amazed look on the faces of her brother and sisters, she burst into tears. I didn't mean to do it, she said. It was just so easy. When she was 10, her mother died of tuberculosis, and a few months later, she lost her sister. These traumatic events brought on another loss. She lost her belief in the compassion of God. She also slipped into a deep, deep depression, a condition that would haunt her periodically throughout the rest of her life. Now, at this time, she was unable to enroll in a regular institution of higher learning because, you got it, she was a woman. So she and her sister became involved with the clandestine Flying University. I love this story. This was a Polish patriotic institution of higher learning that initially admitted only women. This clandestine underground educational enterprise operated for 20 years in Warsaw. The courses would appear to be Russian-approved curriculum, but they were actually teaching the children Polish history and other forbidden subjects. When an inspector, a Russian inspector, showed up at the school, a bell would ring, alerting the students to switch their books to hide the Polish texts and pick up the Russian ones. Throughout her life, Marie would never lose her strong sense of her Polish identity. She would always love her native country. As she grew older, her goal was to attend the Sorbonne in Paris. She didn't have the necessary money, so she worked as a governess for several families, and finally she had accrued enough funds to go to school in Paris in 1891. She was now one of 33 women in a class of 1,825 students. She lived under extreme impoverished conditions. Her room was so cold in the morning that the water was frozen in the wash basin. A typical meal was a cup of chocolate or tea and a slice of buttered bread. She threw herself into her studies as if she were personally trying to counteract a popular book of that time. The book was titled The Physiological Feeble-Mindedness of Women. After her final physics exam, she awaited the results with all of the other students. The way they did it then, the examiner would come in and read the name of the individual who received the highest grade first. The name he read that day was Marie Sklodowsky. Never before in the history of the Sorbonne's long history of education had a woman ever been at the top of a physics class. This would not be the last time that they would hear that Polish name read aloud. Her next goal was to get her master's in math, and she was able to pursue that because of a scholarship that was provided. She later would pay back the scholarship, and they said this was something no other recipient had ever done. She worked now in the lab testing magnetic properties of various steels, and it was in that lab that she would meet her life partner, Pierre Curie. He was 35 and physically attractive, but most importantly, he was intellectually attractive. He was already recognized for having invented many instruments that measured electrical charges, and he found this young girl with the delicate features and the acid-stained fingers to be very, very appealing. It was not common to find a beautiful woman in a lab at that time. Pierre proposed to Marie several times, but she turned him down, but then she finally became convinced of his sincerity and agreed to marry him. They were married in 1895. The Curies would begin now their life work together. They had found in each other not only love and a partner, but also a scientific collaborator on whom each one could depend. Marie was pregnant. She gave birth to a healthy baby girl, and they named her Irene. She was an attentive mother, and she tried very hard to balance work and motherhood, but she grew exhausted and depressed and was near a complete breakdown. When Pierre's father, Dr. Curie, offered to move in with them and care for the baby and the house. Now I'm going to deviate for a minute because I want to nominate Dr. Curie as the best father-in-law in the world at this particular point. Marie decided she would now focus her study on these new X-rays, the Becquerel rays. She decided to look into uranium rays as a subject for her doctoral thesis. After an arduous, complex study, she was able to prove that several minerals gave off more energetic rays than did pure uranium. And that research led to a new method of discovering elements. She measured radioactivity, and that led them to something totally new, atomic science. In the process, she also coined a new term, radioactivity. First time anyone had heard of these terms. Over the next 4 years, the Curies would publish jointly or separately a total of 32 scientific papers. The Academy of Science finally awarded her a prestigious award, but the chauvinistic all-male Academy wouldn't even tell Marie that she had won because, remember, she was a woman. Instead, they had Pierre tell her that she had won. Friends were now worried about the health of both Pierre and Marie. They were concerned that the couple didn't get enough food, they didn't get enough rest, because nothing mattered to them but physics. It was as necessary to them as breathing. In 1901 and the following year, 1902, the Curies and Becquerel were nominated for the Nobel Prize, but they were bitterly disappointed when they didn't win. And then the next year, in a display of cruel sexism, Marie Curie was left off the nomination. It was a shocking example of what it was like to be a woman in science at that time. And even though her amazing discoveries were known throughout the scientific world, she was not accepted as an equal in a male-dominated field. So Pierre responded, he could not, he would not accept the prize unless it included Marie. And finally, the committee added her name to the nomination. So on December 1903, the Royal Swedish Academy of Science awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics to Pierre Curie, Marie Curie, and Henri Becquerel. Marie was 36. She was the first woman to receive the Nobel Prize in Science, and she would remain the only one for the next 32 years until her daughter Irene would win the honor in 1935. Now, after they won the Nobel Prize, the peaceful life of the Curies was totally changed. They were thrust in the spotlight now. They were bombarded by the press, requests for interviews and to make appearances. And at long last, the Sorbonne offered them a new science chair with a laboratory and paid assistants. The world was now involved in the radium craze, which would last for 40 years. At this point, radioactive radium was added to tea, health tonics, water, bathtubs, face creams. No one knew or recognized how dangerous it was. Pierre and Marie were unaware of the effects of radiation exposure, and they continued throughout their lifetime to work with radioactive substances totally unprotected. In 1904, a second daughter, Eve, was born. Now, all Nobel laureates are usually invited to Stockholm to present a lecture, and Pierre, of course, was asked to give it. Marie wasn't even allowed to sit on the stage with him, but from the podium, he acknowledged her and he gave her full credit. But when they returned to Paris, there would be tragedy. One morning, Marie was rushing to get the girls ready for the morning events, and she was short-tempered with Pierre. And later in the day, he was crossing the street in a pouring rain when he was struck by a heavily loaded horse-drawn wagon, and that wheel rolled over his head and crushed that brilliant skull. He was dead at 49, and when she was told, Marie was devastated. They had to literally rip her away from him to prepare his body for burial. She now fell into a chronic state of depression, and she was relieved only by throwing herself into her work. Not even her children could pull her out of this depressed state, but the lab was her safe haven, and the Sorbonne had asked her to take Pierre's place, which she agreed to do. Her employees now grew from 8 to 42 scientists, and 20 of those would be women. Over the next 3 years, she would continue with this grueling work. And then, in 1910, she met Paul Langevin. He was a former student of Pierre's. He was 5 years younger than Marie. He was a brilliant mathematician and a physicist, and he was also married. She was drawn to his exceptional intelligence, and she felt life was maybe giving her a second chance. And they became lovers. His wife had never felt threatened by other affairs, but this was different. This was the famous Marie Curie. She stalked Marie. She even threatened to kill her. And Paul admitted she was probably capable of carrying out that threat. Still, she was living at this time like a hunted animal. One day she received a telegram saying she had won another Nobel Prize, but this time in a different field, in chemistry. And at the same time, she simultaneously received a telegram from Paul Langevin's wife saying she had released all their love letters to the press. And their affair was now exposed. And she was vilified. She received notorious publicity. I couldn't help but think a little bit of, some of you will remember, the affair between Ingrid Bergman and Rossellini. And they were on an island, and the press came out that she was pregnant. She was married to someone else. For years, she could not come back to America, even really to visit, because the press was so vitriolic about her. And I think when you have portrayed Joan of Arc, we assume you are a saint. And they had done this with Marie Curie. They presumed she was a saint. Some of the professors demanded that she leave Paris. Many people turned their backs on her. None of this would have happened if she had been a man accused of the same thing. Stockholm was still going to give her the Nobel Prize, but they asked her not to appear, not to come in person. But she went outwardly proud and confident, and she went and stood there and took full credit for her work. Finally, the scandal died down. We were involved now with the Second World War, and the Curies would do more than their part. She carried the French national treasure in a suitcase that was all of the radium of France. She carried it in a suitcase and kept it beside her bed at night. She devised portable X-rays to be used on the battlefield. She helped organize the women of France by equipping their ordinary cars and turning them into ambulances that were called the Little Curies. Pierre's research was used to create the first sonar to capture vibrations made by submarines. And 17-year-old Irene did her part. She ran radiology facilities, trained others, and repaired equipment, all while attending the Sorbonne like her mother and graduating with honors in math, physics, and chemistry. And finally, the war was over, and Poland was declared an independent country and was finally free after 123 years of Russian rule. Marie's health was now in serious decline. She was almost blind. She was weak and listless from anemia caused by radiation, and there were serious financial concerns. She received a modest pension from the government, but it was nothing like the financial security other companies gave their scientists. Salvation would come from America, from an American woman and her magazine, Missy Maloney, and her publication, The Delineator, and from the American Association of University Women. They invited Marie to America, and they gave her a gift, a gram of radium worth $100,000. She also received other gifts of equipment and money, and this allowed her to pass her legacy on to her daughter, Irene. She was honored in America, but not so much in France. The two daughters she had were very different. Irene was brilliant, emotionless, kind of like ice. She fell in love with a young laboratory assistant, Frederick Joliot. They had much the same relationship as Marie and Pierre had had. They worked and published together. In 1935, the couple who used both surnames and went as Joliot Curie won the Nobel Prize for discovering how to create artificial radioactivity. She was the second woman to win that prize in science after her mother. Eve, the one who'd been sort of left out as a child, was very attractive and fashionable and artistically gifted. She dreamed of becoming a concert pianist, but her mother would complain of the noise whenever she played. The Curies had always protected their employees from rays, but never themselves. They even kept a vial on the nightstand. They liked to look at that dazzling glow. So now, radium burns are causing splits and calluses on Marie's hands, and her fingertips have become numb. Radiation had penetrated her bones. She entered the hospital in 1934, and she suffered horribly in her last months. Eve that child that she had shut out, now became her devoted companion. She would periodically have to leave the room because she was unable to bear seeing her mother in such agony. Marie Curie died July 4th, 1934, of radiation poisoning. She was 66 years old. Irene, too, would die of leukemia caused by radioactive materials when she was 58. And her husband, he would die 2 years later. But Eve went on to become a concert pianist and an author. She married and worked for NATO and UNICEF and other humanitarian organizations. She was articulate and eloquent, but she always felt guilty because she had escaped the consequences of radium. She would live to be 102. Because of the levels of radioactivity, Marie's papers from the 1890s are considered too dangerous today to handle. Even her cookbook is highly radioactive. All of her things are kept in lead-lined boxes. She has a signature place in our history. She was the first person to win 2 Nobel Prizes. Today, she is the only woman to have won 2 Nobel Prizes in 2 different scientific fields. And that concludes the story of these 3 amazing women, the treacherous, the bold, and the brilliant. I'm often asked, why did I pick these 3 subjects? And I can't really give you a good reason. I just liked their stories myself and wanted to share them. They're all different. They all have different abilities. They are from different areas, different times, but each one of them is a survivor of the time in which they lived, a survivor in a world dominated by men. And I feel each one of them is worthy of our consideration today. Some of you have heard me speak before and know that I often like to end with a poem or a quote or the words of a song or something that pulls it all together. And I was trying to find something that fit these remarkable women and remarkable women everywhere. And I think I found it, with thanks to Helen Ruddy. I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore. And I know too much to go back and pretend, 'cause I've heard it all before. And I've been down there on the floor, and no one's ever gonna keep me down again. Oh yes, I am wise, but it's wisdom born of pain. Yes, I've paid the price, but look how much I gained. If I have to, I can do anything. I am strong. I am invincible. I am woman. Thank you for coming. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.